So much for your care over us through the week. We ask the blessing of your Spirit on our service this morning for this very special communion service where we, in this time of year, we take a moment to really contemplate what you've done for us through your crucifixion, burial, and resurrection. Thank you for that special bond that we have with each other through you that is also represented by what we do in this communion service. Bless us with your Spirit now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please remain standing for hymn number 166. Despite chaos in this world, we have peace because of the Lord. Say amen. Amen. We have a very important announcement Mark is going to make. Are you still doing that, Mark? Or did you want me to do it?
Just a reminder about prayer after.
Yeah, we're doing something very, very, very important starting today. Right after worship service,
Mark Papendick's small group wants to invite all the church members to join them in a moment of prayer at the front of the sanctuary for peace in the world, for our church, for our community, for all the needs that are around us and in the world. So they want to make a special time. I think that's a great gesture to invite the congregation to. So if you want to join them in prayer, please do so after the worship service. And at this time, we're going to have a special treat of the children's choir. Am I right? Yeah.
Good morning. special weekend, isn't it? What weekend is it? What are we celebrating?
Easter.
And what does Easter mean to you?
It's about God being crucified. It's not about hiding eggs.
That's right. It's about God being crucified. What else? It's about God rising again, not about the Easter Bunny. What else?
I don't get how, like, if which one is Easter? The where he rose again or where he got crucified? Which one?
Well, it's about the whole weekend. It's all important. Now, I want to ask you, who knows what sin means? What is sin? Anybody know what sin means? Can anybody tell me?
Sin means like you do something bad.
You do something bad or you disobey God. Well, I need a volunteer that knows how to spell the word sin. Who knows how to spell sin? Sin comes in many different colors, so who wants to spell sin? Come on down, here's a color for you, here's a color for you. And let's go, oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Do me a favor and write down the word sin. Big, bigger. Sometimes we have small sins, sometimes we have big sins. So let's do all sizes of sins. Nice. Okay, very good. Now, you know that Jesus died on the cross for us and he shed his blood. What does it mean by he shed his blood? He died to be able to forgive us and so that we would be able to live with him forever, right? So what I'd like to show you is because of Jesus' big heart and his love for us. Can you hold that up to everybody so they can see the sin? And when we put Jesus' love cover and forgive us, what do you end up seeing?
No sin.
Nothing. The sin is gone. Look. The sin is there, but with Jesus' love and the shedding of his blood on the cross, the sin is gone. I want you to remember this as we celebrate this Easter weekend, to remember that because of God's love, he was crucified, he died, he shed his blood, and that we will be able to live with him forever. Will you remember that? Say amen. No, a little louder.
Amen.
All right, you may go to Children's Church. Thank you.
Thank you.
does a hallelujah mean? Do you know? Anybody? Hooray! Hallelujah. That's pretty close. It's an exclamation. It is an expression of praise and joy. And I think offering is just that. Do you need to be reminded from time to time who you are in God? How you have been saved by the grace of God, despite your sins, that your sins have been covered by the blood of Christ? Do you need to be reminded of how fortunate you are to have God in your life, living in your heart? Do you need to be reminded of how joyous and joyful we can be knowing who we are in God, for our destiny to be secured? Although we have died, that we are resurrected with Christ. Do you need to be reminded of this? Well, you are being reminded right now. And let hallelujah come out as we give our hearts back to the Lord through offering. Will the deacons please come forward? Father God, hallelujah. Amen. You are truly deserving of our praise and glory. Each time we are reminded of who you are to us and what you have done for us, all we can say is alleluia. And so, Lord, we give this offering as a token of our entire lives offered to you, as you have first offered your entire life to us and for us, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
God is a magnificent God. He's always giving us chances and opportunities to begin again on the beginning of every day. In God's eyes, our sins and mistakes of yesterday are in the past. We come to such realization when we claim Jesus' resurrection power each and every day in our lives. Every morning we want to thank God for His new mercies by claiming Jesus' resurrection power for that particular day. Thus I have a prayer for you. This prayer is a reminder that Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection were not in vain, and that dying daily to self is the ultimate expression of gratitude to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for dying on the cross for our sins. I would like to share these prayers with you. If you are able, please kneel as we pray. Good morning, Father. Thank you for allowing us to wake up this beautiful morning and experience a new day. Thank you for not letting us waste this day with selfishness, laziness, greed, stupidity, negative thoughts, and other sins. Help us to make the best of this day, knowing that the blood that you shed already covers our life for this day. Help us to use this day to move closer to your image and likeness and to become the person that you call us to be. Help us to use this day to practice holiness and purity that can be achieved when we die daily to our own thoughts, feelings, and desires and claim your resurrection power for our life. Help us to understand that your life, death, and resurrection were not in vain. Every time a negative thought begins to form in our mind, help us instead to be grateful that you suffered unbearably just for us. That you suffered so that we did not have to. That means we can give all our worries and cares to you while at the same time moving forward because of your resurrection power that brings dead things to life. We claim your resurrection power on this day to cover our mind, body, and soul, our health and finances, our family, our friends, and each and every area of our lives in Jesus' name. We understand that by claiming your resurrection power for our life daily, we are joyful in Jesus' name. We have all our needs met in Jesus' name. We are healthy in Jesus' name. We are made whole in Jesus' name. We are healed, delivered, and set free because we claim the power of your resurrection for our life daily in Jesus' name. Help us to remember this as long as we live, that each new day is an opportunity to recognize, claim the power of your resurrection. I pray in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior name. Amen.
Have you ever heard the phrase, those who know not real suffering know not real joy? Have you heard something like that before? Do you think that's true? Do we have to know suffering in order to know real joy? I don't know how true that is, but certainly In the Christian faith, suffering and death has grave significance, no pun intended. Suffering and death is presented, especially in the New Testament passage for today, as a catalyst, as the main ingredient for life, like a seed that must be buried in the ground in order for it to sprout into life. So let's take a look at this passage in Romans 6 together. Romans 6, verses 3 to 11. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Ready? We were therefore with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ. All right, let's go back to the first verse of this passage. It says, don't you know that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? What does that mean? I mean, we get baptized to have a new life, not in order to die, right? And yet this verse makes it seem like the purpose of baptism is death, so that we can die and be buried with Christ. It says in the following verses, it goes on about how important it is that we are buried, that we are crucified with Christ. In other verses, it says. So I think there is a step that we want to skip in this process. We want to go from being sinners to bliss. We don't want the step in the middle of sacrifice and death. We don't like it so much that I think our Christianity as of late have really emphasized the grace of God that gives us salvation for free. And nothing that we have to do to be saved. In fact, I believe that. In fact, that is true. However, salvation is free, but the life we live in Christ is a life of calling from God for us to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, to suffer and to die in order to be resurrected. And that's what this verse is talking about, the life with Christ. How can you resurrect someone who is not dead? Death is a necessity for resurrection. And if we are to be resurrected with Christ into the new life in God, we must first die, is what this passage is saying. And that's why baptism is so significant. Because being underwater, being buried, dying to our old self, as this passage says, is the necessary part to be raised up into the new life. That's what baptism really signifies. It signifies the Easter weekend, of the crucifixion of Christ that we join in. Yes, Christ died for our sins, and through his blood we are saved, but he also asks us to experience the joy of the resurrection, which can only come if we are dead. So, is death a catalyst for life? Absolutely. If we are to experience the new life in Christ through the resurrection, we must first die. If we want to be first, we must become last. If we want to save ourselves, we must lose ourselves. And I'm so glad that the deacons asked to have the communion on the Easter weekend. Because you know what communion is, right? Communion is rebaptism for the saints. You know, we get to do this once a quarter. Some churches do it every week. And we really need that. We really need that experience of dying with Christ to be resurrected again. We need that rebaptism over and over again to remind ourselves, because we are so forgetful, aren't we? We always go to the garage to get something, and when we get there, we don't, why am I here? And that's what happens to us all the time in the busyness of life. That's why gathering together to be reminded of this is so important. And this once a year celebration is just a big celebration of what we celebrate every week, every day, every moment. Do I have time to say one more thing about death, suffering and death? Do I? Okay, 2 minutes. Okay, so we know what the purpose of death is. You must die to be resurrected. What is the purpose of suffering? Have you asked this before? Suffering seems so needless. Why must we suffer? What is the purpose of suffering? This is what I think. God does not cause suffering, but God uses something so terrible in our lives as something useful. Have you experienced that in your life? So as terrible as suffering is, and when you're in the middle of it, it's agonizing, it's painful. You don't want to go through it. And God suffers with you, by the way. Those of you that have asked the question of, where are you, God, in my suffering? Why have you abandoned me? Why couldn't you stop and prevent this from happening? I want to tell you that God weeps with you in your suffering. He suffers with you. And I can testify to that, having a sick child. I want to suffer instead of him, because I feel like the mental agony is so intense. So God, I want you to know that God suffers with you in your suffering. But what is the purpose of it? What is the purpose? Why must we? Well, there might not be a reason for it, but I think what God does is he uses suffering as a form of death to make you eligible for resurrection. Suffering and pain it only exists in the imperfect life where there is death. Suffering is a sort of a mirror image of our mortality. It is a indication of our frailty. It is it talks about the imperfect life, and it is a form of death. And so what I'm telling you is, those of you that suffer and think this is for naught, this is needless, I think it is needless still. But God, in his wisdom, uses your suffering to make you a better candidate for the resurrection. You know, when I was, a long time ago, when I was waiting in line for the new iPhone to come out before the store opened, we all lined up and I waited for hours. And when the store opened, the guy came out and said, "We're sorry, the delivery was not made, and we don't have the iPhones." But I know that you guys waited so long since the crack of dawn, so we're gonna give you vouchers to get free iPhones when it comes. Actually, that did not happen. You were like, wait, what's that? Why wasn't I there? No, that did not happen. But what really does happen, I think, in reality of the universe, is those of you that go through immense amount of suffering in this life, I think God says, you know what? Yeah, here's a voucher for you, for the resurrection of that joy with Christ, that new life in Christ. You know, I know you're totally confused why I am giving you this voucher, God says. I know that you're thinking, what is this? Why? And you don't think that you deserve it, because in your suffering, you were perhaps angry with God. Perhaps you did not get along with God for so many years. But I want to tell you, God says, I count your suffering as death. And that death is enough to make you a candidate for the resurrection. Isn't that beautiful? I really believe that. And you can see it all throughout the Bible. You know, like a prostitute, Rahab. A prostitute was considered righteous. Who else was there? There was Zacchaeus, the tax collector. And he had a change of life. All these unexpected sinners receiving the voucher from God. The thief on the cross received a voucher for what? What did he do? What did he do in his life? And I think God says, look, those to all of you suffer in this world. And perhaps if this is true, because everyone suffers, perhaps we are all eligible for the resurrection. Wouldn't that be nice? Amen. As we prepare ourselves for this rebaptism through communion, I'd like to ask you to contemplate and prepare our hearts as we have this a song of meditation from the piano. Thank you.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you so much that we have another season to celebrate and contemplate what you did for us, your death and resurrection. And we thank you for that gift of sharing in the inheritance of your Son. Everything that you promised to us and taught us. And we remember those things that you taught your disciples on that last Passover that you shared with them. And we know that because you live, we live, and we're grateful for that. So we ask your blessing on this service and our service to each other and to the community. In Jesus' name.
By partaking of Christ's body and blood, we also partake in his death and resurrection. Hence, communion is rebaptism for the saints. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Amen. We share in Christ's sacrifice. As he shed his blood for us, we also follow in his footsteps to sacrifice our lives. And in doing so, we experience death, which inevitably results in the resurrection. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Congratulations on your rebaptism. Now you have risen from the dead, as Christ did on that Easter day. And now you can live with the newness of life until we meet again. Let's stand and sing together the final hymn, "Hail the Day That Sees Him Rise," number 176. God's sacrifice and death, it becomes a way of life for those who follow. And this is one of the reasons why we always remember those that are suffering and collect a needy relief offering at the door during communion. And so I'm proud of that tradition, that in our following of Christ, we're always remembering to look for those that are suffering in our midst, to pray for them, to do whatever we can to alleviate their suffering and pain. And I pray that this is the kind of life we live as we leave this place, that we continue the ways of Christ. Happy Easter, everyone.